Now, this morning, I'm not going to direct you to turn to one particular place in the Bible. We are actually jumping ship from our series on the prophets. For us, we're actually officially done the series on the prophets. And we are going to be doing a couple of standalone sermons before we head into our next series on Sunday, September the 8th, a series called Ask. It's a series all about prayer, and so all of our campuses will be on that for the next 2 weeks. However, we are going to be doing something completely different. Now, I don't know if you remember the show. It was a TV show. It was super popular. In fact, I'd be surprised if some of you didn't watch it all the time. It was the show Cheers. It aired a long time ago now, from 1982. Between 1982 and 1993, long time. It had enormous success. In fact, it won 6 Golden Globes, and who can forget the theme song, right? The theme, where everybody knows your name, that's what it's called. You remember the song? I'm not going to sing it. Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? All those nights when you've got no lights, the check is in the mail, and your little angel hung the cat by its tail, and your third fiance didn't show, sometimes you want to go where everybody knows your name, and they're always glad you came. You want to be where you can see our troubles are all the same. You want to be where everybody knows your name. And the song goes on and on like that, right? And when you think about Cheers, what was Cheers all about? It was really all about community, wasn't it? It was all about, yeah, sure, it was centered around a bar, though, wasn't it? A local bar where people from all kinds of walks of life would gather together in that local bar for community, at least at some level. So it was such a hit, I think, because it struck a chord in all of us. The lyrics on that song show us that we all look for some place that we can belong, a place where everybody knows your name and they're always glad you came, even if they do that just because you're paying for Starbucks coffee. Like, we're glad you came to get coffee from us. That's why we're glad you're here. But when I come in and they greet me by name, it's good, isn't it? When you go to the local grocery store, if you've seen them repeatedly over and over and again, and they start to know you, or at the gas station, it's nice when people start knowing you by name, and they're glad you're there. You see, no matter what trouble we face, what lousy thing has happened to us, we like the idea of having a place where we can go, where everybody knows our name, and they're glad we came. Well, why is that? Well, I think at the core of that is the recognition that there is God. And God has made us to belong, hasn't he? He's created us, in fact, for community. He made us to be a part of relationship, not only with him, but also with others. In fact, the first place that we belong, that we find true belonging, a true sense of sort of like connectedness, is actually in a relationship with him. With Jesus Christ. It all starts there. And once that connection with him is established in a relationship with Jesus Christ, we also find that what we really need to belong is to belong to the family that he has formed together. The people that say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. We gather together. That's why we meet at church. We're a group of followers of Jesus. And maybe not everybody is here, but you know, we come together because we worship Jesus Christ. So God made us to belong to him. He made us to have what the Bible calls fellowship with one another. The idea of fellowship is the idea of sharing or partnering with each other in the things of life, in all of life. You know, belonging to God's family is very different in some senses than belonging to maybe a club, a sports team. Those are kinds of gatherings. Those are sorts of community that get developed around it. I'm part of a jiu-jitsu community where I go. There's a type of community that's there that I find meaningful and valuable to me, but it's different than this kind of community. It's not the same. For example, someone might find, just like in Cheers, community at a local bar, a neighborhood bar. Bruce Larson, for example, said this, The neighborhood bar is possibly the best counterfeit there is to the fellowship Christ wants to give his church. It's an imitation, dispensing liquor instead of grace, escape rather than reality. But it is a permissive, accepting, and inclusive fellowship. It is unshockable. It is democratic. You can tell people secrets, and they usually don't tell others or want to. The bar flourishes not because most people are alcoholics, but because God has put into the human heart the desire to know and be known, to love and be loved, and so many seek a counterfeit at the price of a few beers. You know, this isn't an indictment against a bar, right? This is a statement, really, about where do people go when they want to find some sense of belonging? They can find it in all kinds of places. But there's a certain level of belonging and community, a type of community that one actually cannot find in any other place that's out there in the world, and that's the community that's within the family of God. So God's plan for us is that we would first and foremost enter into his family by becoming followers of Jesus Christ, but then he desires that we would belong to his family, the church, to other Christ followers, that we would connect with each other, that we wouldn't be sort of isolated or independent, sort of out there doing it on my own kind of Christian, but we would be together. This is God's plan. It's always been his plan from the very beginning. In Acts chapter 2, for example, we see that this was the way that was with the early church. I want you to notice that in Acts chapter 2, 42, what it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers, and awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles, right? So here you have this incredible text. Notice the devotion that they had. They devoted themselves to a number of things, and one of those things is the fellowship. That is the sharing and the partnership that comes together with other followers of Jesus, people who say, I confess faith in Jesus Christ. And so this idea of fellowship is there early on in the New Testament. The early church, they saw the incredible value of fellowship. So in this message this morning, what I want to do is we're talking about community groups, we're talking about discipleship groups, we're talking even this morning about just this gathering right here. We're talking about every kind of gathering that is followers of Jesus Christ together, where fellowship then can happen, where community can happen. And so I'm asking the question, why is fellowship so important to the Christian life? And I want to give you four things to think about. And so if you have notes this morning, you'll follow along, you certainly can do that. But here's what it is. First of all, fellowship helps us to handle the harsh realities of life. It really does. I mean, just imagine not being part of a community, having no one that really truly, truly cares about you when the roof caves in or the floor gives way and all of life falls apart. That's difficult. When we have a genuine sense of belonging and sharing and partnering, this sort of fellowship helps us then to handle those difficult times. Because what we're supposed to be as the church, that is God's people, we're supposed to be the kind of people that take care of each other. That's what fellowship is. Romans 12:15, for example, we're told, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Or 1 Corinthians 12:26 says, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. So fellowship is so important because we all face, or we all will face, in fact, I hate to say it, it could be this afternoon, it could be sometime later this week, it could be sometime this year or in 5 years, but we all face, it's inevitable that we'll all face something. In fact, it may be many things that we face. And who is there to rejoice with those who rejoice? Who's there to weep with those who weep? Who's there to suffer along with somebody else when they suffer? Who's there in your life in Galatians 6:2 when we're told, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ? I can't remember if I mentioned this to you before, but about 10 years ago, I had a particularly low, I hit a particularly low point in my life, about 9 years ago, and I was meeting with my best friend. This was back when we lived in Utah, and I had just had received some just heartbreaking, devastating news. And I remember I was just completely unable to really, I guess, pull myself up through it. I remember I was meeting him for lunch, and I remember sitting in the car, in my car. I got arrived there a little bit earlier, and I remember sinking down low in the seat and just feeling a level of despair that I had never experienced before. And my friend got out of the car. He had pulled up, and he saw me sitting in the car, and he comes over, and he's like, "Hey, what's going on?" Like, he already knew what was going on. And I said, I just don't know if I can make it. I don't think I can do it. I don't know what to do. And he looked at me and said, "Listen, you're going to make it. And I'm going to walk with you every step along the way. You're going to make it. So come on. Let's go inside. Let's get ourselves some tea, and let's just talk about it." So that's what I did. I pulled my body out of that car, and man, was I so glad that I did. I wasn't at the point in my life where I was thinking any sort of suicidal thing. It wasn't that. It was just what was happening in my life was so crushing, so defeating, so discouraging, and I had reached a level of grief that I just had never personally experienced before over something. And he was there as a true friend at that time. And he still is today. He truly was one who, Galatians 6:2 says, bear one another's burdens. He did that for me that day. And we all have to have people like that. I can think of myself as a pastor. Anything could happen to me at any point, just like anything could happen to any one of us. I'll tell you what, I should be glad that I have you in my life, if and when that happens in my life or my family's life. That I know that I have you that will be there with me and through whatever. And I hope that you'd feel the same, that as a family, you'd say, "Well, I'm glad I've got the family. I'm so glad I've got the family. Yeah, I've got other family too, sure, but we sure really need each other, don't we? We need each other." So that's the first thing that we see. Now, you remember the song, in fact, even reminds me of, this is a song day, I guess, for me, but I think of that old song, "Lean On Me," you know? Remember that song? It kind of strikes a chord as well. It's a similar kind of thing, right? Lean on me when you're not strong. I'll be your friend. That's what we need. So when you're in fellowship with other people, it's right, really you making a decision to say, I'm going to connect with the church family in such a way that's actually enabled, that's actually becomes possible. Now, there are a lot of mitigating circumstances that cause people to say, I'm not ready for that. I don't want to do that. I've been hurt. I've been wounded. There's stuff happened. I don't know if I can trust people. It's easy to project onto somebody else what somebody else did to somebody else. Like, there's all kinds of things that go on sort of mentally with us that don't make this just really easy and a slam dunk. But I just want to encourage you that doing the alternative is really not helpful either. It's better to press forward and say, Lord, would you help me to walk through that and heal that so that I can actually find a family like this. So the second reason, though, for fellowship or why it's so important for the Christian life is this, that fellowship helps us to live out the one another commands of the Bible. Sometimes I bump into Christians periodically who say, well, I don't go to church anymore, but I follow Jesus. I used to go to church, but I don't really need church. I believe in Jesus. I have a relationship with him, but I go up on the mountain and I worship God, and I say, wow, that's awesome. It's wonderful to be able to connect with God, and general revelation is amazing, right? General revelation, you look up at the sky, you look at the sun, the moon, the stars. If you get the aurora borealis, you get the wild animals moving about, and you really connect with God in nature. That's wonderful. Yeah, that's great. There's a great place for that. Do you really think you're being an obedient Christian, one who follows the Lord in doing that, if that's all you do? And the answer would be no, you're not. You're not at all. And the reason for that is that it's impossible, it's really impossible to live out what Scripture says apart from community. Because there are over 50 commands in the New Testament that we call one another commands. Maybe you've heard of these. I'm not going to go over all 50 with you this morning, but You can certainly go through the New Testament, or you can just sort of Google it and find the 51 other commands in Scripture, and it's 50 plus commands. I've given you a sample here of those commands in your notes just to give you a little bit of a snapshot. For example, serve one another, accept one another, comfort one another, be at peace with one another, love one another, build up one another, be kind to one another. These are not suggestions in Scripture. These are imperatives. They're commands. I cannot really do these things if I am not part of fellowship. If I disconnect myself from church life, from church people, it's really hard. How do you live this out? And frankly, these commands are not always easy to live out, are they? There are some challenging commands that God has for us. So one of my goals as a follower of Jesus, that I think every follower of Jesus should have, is we should have a mindset where we say, you know, this is what God says the fellowship is all about. These are commands for the family. It's sort of a family guidelines, if you want. So I can simply ask myself, how am I doing at the one another commands as a follower of Jesus? Well, my goodness, if I look at all 50 of them, which ones do I need to work on, Lord? You know, in fact, I've often thought to myself, what if I just took one of those commands a week for 50 weeks? There's 52 weeks in a year, I think, right? So, you get 2 weeks off. I'm just kidding. What I'm saying is there's an intentionality about it, right? There's sort of an intentionality of saying, you know what, when I come to church, I'm not just an observer. I'm not just a person who sort of watches, or I'm not just a person who's coming to be entertained. Rather, I'm coming as a follower of Jesus, and it's not just when I come here. It's always as a Christian, right? Like, when I come, how am I serving others? How am I accepting others? How am I comfort? Is there somebody that needs comfort this morning? Is there somebody that needs me to love them this morning? Is there somebody that I can build up this morning? Is there somebody that I need to go out of my way and be kind to this morning? Is there somebody that I need to forgive this morning? I mean, the list of 50 is incredible. All of these were included to show you and I what true community looks like. And true community, by the way, you might note that if you look at the 50, there's certain things that I didn't include in here, but there are also things like rebuke one another, correct one another, reprove one another. Oh, now that's the hard part of community, right? Because true community isn't just all about fluff, is it? It's not all about just sort of making me feel good. True community cares for each other. That means if there's something in a person's life, then what role might I have in helping my brother and sister? What role might I have? How do I go about doing that? That would really see them as one that Jesus loves, as a disciple of Jesus, and how do I speak into their life to help them? You see, that's what community is supposed to be like. So it's very difficult, as I mentioned, to practice these, to obey these. The idea of sort of being a floating Christian, a traveling Christian, a mobile Christian who, and I've had people in my church plant, my very first church plant, there was a guy who said, you know, I just move where the Spirit wants me to move. And I said, well, I think the Spirit wants you to just find a church that you can call home, brother. I get you see you're God's man who just can float around where the Spirit wants you. And, I mean, God can use you wherever. Don't get me wrong. I'm just saying, like, you know what? Like, you need to commit yourself to a place that you call home. Because it's really easy otherwise to sort of not be committed through all of the different seasons of life in a church and with people. You know, sometimes things just become difficult, right? And you know what? When you get difficult, unfortunately, our culture today says, well, pack it in on your family and quit at the first sign of difficulty often nowadays. But that's not what the church is like, not supposed to be like. So the third reason that fellowship is so important to the Christian life is that fellowship helps us to live graciously with each other, with others. You know, it's really easy. I remember thinking about this. I'm going to give you another song here this morning, okay? Because I think this song kind of just, it reminds me of this very thing. Remember the song, Simon Garfunkel, I'm a Rock? Now, some of you are like, huh? Who's Simon Garfunkel? And like, this really dates this, right? But it goes like this. A winter's day in a deep and dark December, I am alone, gazing from my window to the streets below, on a freshly fallen silent shroud of snow. I am a rock. I am an island. I've built walls, a fortress deep and mighty that none may penetrate. I have no need of friendship. Friendship causes pain. It's laughter and it's loving I disdain. I'm a rock, I'm an island. Don't talk of love, but I've heard the words before. It's sleeping in my memory. I won't disturb the slumber of feelings that have died. If I never loved, I never would have cried. I'm a rock, I'm an island. I have my books and my poetry to protect me. I'm shielded in my armor, hiding in my room, safe within my womb. I touch no one and no one touches me. I'm a rock, I'm an island, and a rock feels no pain, and an island never cries. What a sad song. A tragic song, a song all about a person who certainly has been deeply hurt and wounded. If I never loved, I never would have cried. You hear that in this and you realize that this is a song about a person who has built up protective walls around them, that has said, you know what, thank you, but no thanks. I got my books and my poetry and I'm just fine. Because you know what, those things won't hurt me, but people will. And the truth of the matter is, I would be lying to you if I said to you the church family wouldn't hurt you. I would be lying. I can't tell you that. I can't tell you that I would never hurt you. I can't tell you that. I can tell you that I'd never want to hurt you. I can tell you that. I can tell you that we're sinful, fallen people, every one of us here. If that's new to you, well, it's good information to know. But because we're all sinful, fallen people, we actually do end up hurting each other. And sometimes knowingly, sometimes unknowingly, and you know what? It's always best at that point where we go, this is where fellowship really kicks in too, right? Of a brother or sister, whatever, saying, you know, you hurt me the other day. And then me being able to say, how did I hurt you in this? And have a conversation about that. Oh, man, I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to do that. But would you forgive me? I mean, we try to practice that in our own homes, right? We would try to do it in our own homes where we wouldn't say something like, I'm sorry. And then the other person would say, oh, it's okay. Well, that's actually not okay, right? We were deliberate in our home. Not that we always did this perfectly, but we were deliberate in our home always trying to say, it's not enough to just say it's okay, because it was never okay. What you say is, I forgive you. That's what we need to hear, right? And so when it comes down to these things, this person who's a rock, like part of it is, by God's design, if you think about community, I want you to think about that there's God who exists himself in community, right? He is one being who exists in three persons simultaneously as Father, Son, and Spirit. He himself is his own self-sufficient community. But he also chose to create us. And he put us, that is Adam and Eve, in the garden in community, didn't he? For each other. They needed each other. Adam needed Eve. Eve needed Adam. Both created uniquely by God in his design. And God, in doing that, creating family. Family is a sense of community, isn't it? And the church is another sense of community, isn't it? And in both of those areas, you can experience hurt. And you experience hurt because you're dealing with people now since the fall of Adam and Eve who are just fallen people. And we're going to hurt each other. But in designing it this way, God basically put us into the kind of community where he knows we actually need this. If we didn't have community, we wouldn't learn so much about what we need to know, how to relate and function properly in life and with each other. It's actually in community that you really get to mature and to grow and to develop and to grow in Christ-likeness. So before I was married, I would think to myself, I'm a follower of Jesus. I came to know Christ at 17. And you know what? I got this thing pretty good. Like, I'm not a selfish person. I mean, I was really starting to know the word. I felt pretty good. And then I got married. And I realized, man, in community, I can be kind of selfish. Like, a little bit of an awakening at that moment. You know, and then you have kid number one that comes along. Super strong-willed, stubborn. Just like her mom. I'm scanning the room for my wife right now. We're going to have some community problems afterwards here, folks. No, I say that because it's actually me. But and then number two comes along. Kid number three comes along. Kid number four comes along. And then you're like, I got to get out of Utah before I have more kids. But with each kid that comes along and each personality, you realize that, my goodness, like, these little monsters, at some point you feel like, goodness, like when they're little, especially like their wills, and they're like, your wills are not complying with what I want. And community then becomes even more challenging, right? I wouldn't exchange being married for anything in the world. I wouldn't exchange having kids for anything in the world. Well, in the church, it's similar to that, right? We willfully say, and God wants us to be in that community. But when you're in that community, part of that is having to learn how to live as a community. And one of the things that we get to do is we get to learn how to live graciously with others. And that's not always easy, because some of us might be more gracious than others. I mean, let's be honest about this. I'm not pointing out anybody, because I have no knowledge of anybody that's like this, but some people are a little bit like porcupines, aren't they? You kind of get a little close and you kind of, ow, that kind of hurt. I got their quill stuck in me. And a lot of times people are like that. Why? Because, well, so many things have happened in their lives. They're, you know, hurting people hurt other people. It's kind of the way that it is. But how do we live graciously with each other? Romans 14 has an extended text that Paul gives us about this very thing in the early church, where they're having difficulty living graciously with each other over particular matters from that first century. I want to read this to you from Romans 14. Paul says, as for the one who is weak in faith, he's talking about in the congregation in Rome, differences that are existed among them. So as for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. One person believes he may eat anything, while the weak person eats only vegetables. Now, just at the outset of the reading this passage, we're talking about those who were Gentiles who came to faith in Jesus Christ, and those who were Jews who came to faith in Jesus Christ. And if you want to sort of, you know, see an explosion happen, just kind of bring those two groups together. This was probably the largest challenge in the early church, when the gospel went to both groups and the both groups came and formed the church. Talk about differences of way of thinking about things. Very different. So here they are in one church, and he says, I don't want you to quarrel over opinions. One believes he may eat anything. The weak person eats only vegetables. Let not the one who eats despise the one who abstains. You can see the behavior now coming out amongst them. Let not the one who eats despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats, for God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls. And he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One person esteems one day as better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day, quite likely referring to the Jews' sabbatical day, the Sabbath day, which would be Saturday, observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God. While the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. If we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. He's just really underscoring, boy, there's some real differences between the Jews and the way they were thinking after they came to know Jesus Christ about their faith. And how would they let go of certain things that they would eat or not eat, or certain days that they said these are really important days, like the Sabbath day, for example. And then you have Gentiles who have no regard for any of those things, who would eat things that would be like, oh my goodness, the Jews would be like, why are you eating that? That's disgusting. You shouldn't be eating that. Man, talk about having problems in your church potlucks, right? That's something that we can give thanks for. We don't have that problem at our potlucks. Verse 10, why do you pass judgment on your brother, or why do you despise your brother? You see that language? Verse 13, therefore let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of a brother. And he goes on and he talks about how your brother or your sister, if they're grieved by what you eat, you're not walking in love. So do not let what you regard as good be spoken of as evil. The kingdom of God, in verse 17, is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. And so if you read this text, you really spend time in this text, you discover that, yeah, in the early church, there was significant conflict going. Conflict's nothing new in the church, right? We have conflict today, and people go, oh my goodness, there's conflict in the church. And it's like, welcome to a gathering of sinful people all under one roof, professing faith in Jesus Christ, where we are sinful people and we're going to at times have problems. It's not complicated to me. I've been around it for a long time. It gets messy sometimes. But what we want to do, I always step back from that kind of reality and go, okay, but how do we do this as followers of Jesus together, right? Because there's a right way and there's a wrong way. I mean, just consider the diversity and differences that exist here, right? I mean, there's the obvious differences of male and female. That's difference enough, right? There's all kinds of men are from Mars and women are from Venus, kind of whatever that book was, right? Like, there's differences. Thank God for the differences. I would really just dislike if I led a church just of men. That would be so unbelievably boring, right? Thank God, right? We need male and female. But think also the various family backgrounds that are here. I mean, we all have stuff in our families. And then you think about the various religious backgrounds. Not everybody comes from a third or fourth generation follower of Jesus. Some of it maybe came out of witchcraft or paganism or Scientology. It could be anything under the sun, but you came to know Jesus. Or think about the various political views and ideas that are maybe represented even in this room. I mean, you want to talk about blowing up kind of a church. I don't mean literally, but we'll get involved in having too many political conversations around. And why would we want to do that with one another, right? So it's these things. You could go on and on about the diversity. So what is it that really brings us together? It's Jesus that brings us together, right? He's the core and the anchor of it all. But this is where grace comes in, because in the midst of all of that diversity that exists, we have to learn to be gracious with one another. And you don't learn to be gracious with each other by not being a part of diverse things, right? You learn it by being in the mix. You know, a brother has a different view on something than you have, or does something different than you has. We're not talking about things that like are pure violations of the Word of God that are going against what God's clear commands are. We're not talking that. We're just talking about, you know, it could be a particular issue, a Bible issue, a way to handle a passage. It could be about clothing. It could be about a whole host of issues like that. But are we going to learn to be gracious with each other? True community is always seeking to do that. Always seeking to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, as the Apostle Paul tells us. So that's the third thing that fellowship does. The fourth thing is this: fellowship helps us to understand, or I should say, fellowship helps us to stand strong spiritually. In Acts 2, verse 47, remember the early church, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. So the early church really understood this. They really understood when they would gather together, no matter where they were gathering. In the early days, in the temple courts, they would gather, and then they moved into homes, and they would gather in homes, and then a few centuries later, they started building buildings and gathering in buildings. But the church is the church. It's not the building. It's the people, right? So when we gather together as the church, there's a devotion that's there, and the early church devoted themselves to the fellowship, but to the prayers, to breaking of bread, which is kind of probably like a communion or a meal that they would participate in together. And they would also devote themselves to the apostles' teaching, the Word of God. And to really grow as a follower of Jesus, fellowship is absolutely essential in that. We gather together on a Sunday morning and we hear God's Word. We're challenged, we're encouraged, we're reminded, we're corrected at times, we're maybe just receive information that might be new to us on a particular time. What we really gather around the Word of God, and we hear from God's Word, and that's how we're strengthened. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 and 25, the author of Hebrews said, "Let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. So just the importance of that regular gathering together. Why do pastors and church leaders always say, gather, 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 make a commitment to church? Because we know that when the commitment to attending worship is low, then most likely the spiritual life will begin to suffer. You remember that ancient illustration or example, for those of you who maybe remember back in the day, and maybe you still do it, when you would barbecue something using those charcoal briquettes, I think they were called, or charcoal something. You know, you buy that bag of charcoal, and you didn't have propane back then that we'd use. You just put that in your barbecue thing, and then you'd get your barbecue lighter, whatever you used, for try to get those things lit. And then you would light it up, and they would burn, and it would take a while. You'd have to start your barbecue like 3 days before you're having your barbecue. Yeah, because if you invited people over and started it, like, good luck, you're not eating till 10 o'clock at night, right? And you get that thing going, and then, but man, that thing gets scorching hot, and when those briquettes or whatever they're called, is that the right word? Briquettes, okay. It just sounds really French to me for some reason. I thought maybe it's a remnant from my Canadian days. I thought, so those things would get like white hot, right? And you know, sometimes even the next morning, you would like take the lid off that barbecue, and you're like, man, they're still like white. You could still roast something on these things. But you know the story, maybe, the illustration. You take some tongs, and you take one of those charcoal briquettes, and you put it to the side. It doesn't take very long, does it? And that one little charcoal piece is cold as ice. But you keep them together in their nice huddle, and they stay warm. It's a simple illustration, but the reality is true, that we need each other and we need commitment to church. And it's not just simply so we can check a box. That's not why we gather. We gather every Sunday morning to worship our God together, to fellowship with each other, to pray, to hear from God through His Word, to offer the kind of one another support and encouragement to each other in the commands. We serve each other. We use our gifts with one another. That's the church of Christ that gathers. So what can you do then? What can you do? How do you sort of take this message and apply it to your own life? How do you respond? Well, if you want to belong, then there is certainly some measure of responsibility that every individual needs to take. It's always said, if you want to have friends, then you got to be friendly, right? It sure helps. If you want to get to know others, then you also have to take the initiative at times. There's also those of us who just need to take the initiative, look across the room or look down the aisle, look down the row, to be the kind of church that's not having to be programmed into community and fellowship, but the kind of church that just is. You know, when somebody says, hey, I don't know you, I'd love to get to know you. When somebody says, hey, you know, we're having some friends over and I'd love for you to join us. In fact, we're having a barbecue. Would you come? They may not be able to come, but the fact that they were invited. To be that kind of people, spontaneous, you doing it, not programmed, not because we had it in the plans. Certainly there's a place for that. September 8th, we'll gather for a barbecue. But to be that kind of people. To have those people in your home, to hang around and talk with others after the worship service has ended, to have an eye to those maybe who you've not met before and say, I'm going to cross the room to meet them, to join a community group if you haven't done that, to attend any special events that come, to communities built there as well, to be a part of a discipleship group when those get launched here at our campus, to have the consistency of coming to church on Sunday morning. All of these come together in a way that really builds healthy, strong community that is a blessing for you and for everyone else. This morning, we're going to take communion together, and I can't think in some ways of a maybe good visible illustration probably of community, right? This is all of us who, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, like you've asked Him to come into your life and forgive you of your sins, this is an opportunity for you to come to the front, and Pastor Flav and team will lead us in worship, and you come to the front and you will take the cup, and you'll take the bread, and you'll make your way back to the seats, and then Pastor Flav will lead us through the elements here in a moment. But really, this is all about you saying, I believe in Jesus. He is my Savior and Lord. I believe in the cup, which represents the blood of Jesus Christ when he died on the cross for my sins. He did that for me. The bread representing the body of Christ, which when he hung upon the cross, he gave up that life for me, his body. And we take those symbols today because this is a remembrance for us that we've entered into a relationship with Jesus Christ. We belong to him, but we do it as a community. Right? It's the community remembering this. And it's for this reason that Paul in 1 Corinthians 11 asks us as a church, reminds us that we should not go ahead of somebody else in taking communion, and we shouldn't be eating in isolation and things like that. Because in the first century, the problem was this. The church, when they were gathering, it wasn't done like this. They actually had a full-on meal in many respects, probably. And what they were doing in Corinth is that they were segregating themselves, actually. So you had actually one group of people, probably the more wealthy and influential, who would gather and they would eat their meal. And then it was a class system, so you would have another class of individuals who would come in later and they would sit in another room altogether and they would eat next. When you read 1 Corinthians 11 and you read it with that backdrop in mind, it's helpful to understand because it wasn't like we often do today where we say, well, we have to take communion and let's all hold the cup to our lips and then all of us take it at the same time. You actually don't have to do that. That's not what Paul's saying in 1 Corinthians 11. He's actually dealing with those who are actually treating other people shamefully in the church, right? They were segregating off, saying, well, we're the more wealthy and influential. We get to eat. You guys can eat later. No, when you come together as the church, none of that matters. It doesn't matter what your degrees are. It doesn't matter what your social class is. None of that matters because we're all here at the foot of Jesus. We're all on equal footing with him in this room when we gather. And we gather, and this is a way of saying, you know, I belong to Jesus and I belong to the community. We're in this together. And so Paul then admonishes the church in Corinth, if you do have problems among you, if there is this kind of divisive behavior, don't take communion. Don't take communion. It's upsetting. It's not good for the church. So don't take it in that case. So there is a place for us to reflect upon our own hearts and then come. And so I would encourage you to come this morning. And Flav, would you come and lead us in communion and taking a communion? I want to invite those of you who are going to come forward to come to either one of the tables and to grab the cup and to grab the bread and then make your way back to the seat as we worship God in the taking of communion.